Some new procedures, so I just wanted to take a little bit of time this morning in our welcome and announcements to go over their safety and to make things safe as possible. So we ask that you wear a mask at all times. Now, those of us who are on the altar, we do not wear the mask while we're up here, but as soon as we step off the altar, we will put our masks on. And we will check temperatures, and we ask that if you feel sick, please stay at home. We want to be able to keep everybody safe. And we will practice social distancing with every other pew, and then 6 feet distance between people. And if it's a family, you may all sit together. And then they ask that there not be any congregational singing. But this is what I say. You can sing in your heart. You can hum. You know, Lou's going to tell you to clap a little. So that'll be a good thing. And then the offering, if you will take your offering at the end of the service and put it in the basket as you exit. Same thing with your attendance card. Now, that's new here. Is to have an attendance card, and let me show you one of those. And if you will register your attendance name, address, phone number, email address, all of that, so that we can follow up and stay connected with you. And the ushers then will come and dismiss you at the end of the service. So please wait for their direction. And if you wish to keep your bulletin as you exit, you may, but if not, there's a place for you to put it in the trash. And there's a few announcements coming up. We hope to have a newcomers lunch next Sunday after this service. So if you're interested in joining or want to know more about this church, please join us. We will provide lunch, and it's on us. So let's stand this morning for our call to worship. Trust in the Lord and do good. May the Lord give strength to the people. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
God is our refuge and strength.
Please remain standing for the opening hymn.
We are marching.
We are living in the love of God.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us go to God in prayer this morning. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this time of worship as we gather together in your sanctuary. And also as we gather online, be present with us. We know that you know every single person watching and every single person here in this worship service this morning. And you know the gifts and graces that you've given to each and every one of us. Help us to use those gifts to share your love, to serve your people. Give us joy in our hearts, Lord. Help us to be your witnesses in the world and to be your instruments for peace. And during these times of uncertainties with the coronavirus pandemic and natural disasters, we pray for those who are in need, for recovery, for those who have lost their homes and businesses. We ask that your comfort and peace be with each and everyone who's lost a loved one. And we pray for an end to racism and violence in our world, that we would love one another as you have first loved us. And this morning we come into your house and we confess that we have not done your will. And we ask your forgiveness upon us today. Help us to be more Christ-like. Help us to be faithful to your call on our lives. And most of all, we thank you for your grace and mercy in our lives, for sending Jesus to be here, to live among us, and to show us what that love looks like, to sacrifice and give his life for our eternal life. So we thank you for all of the wonderful gifts you give us. And this morning we come asking for these prayers to be answered. And we pray these prayers together in the powerful and precious name of Jesus, as we pray the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Guys, a question. Okay? Do you like to fish?
No.
Do you like to fish, Mary? Okay, what do you need when you go fishing?
Fishing pole.
Fishing pole? What was that mouse you might need? No?
I need chocolate.
I brought some stuff with me to help us decide what it is. Okay, first I brought a fishing pole. I didn't put it all the way together because it would be really big, right? Okay, so we have a fishing pole. And we have a net. We can't catch very big fish with this, but we can catch fish, right? Okay. And I brought, what's this? Tackle box. What kind of things do you think we would have in a tackle box? Okay, we have this. Bobbers, yeah. And we have some weights that go on the bobbers. And we have some hooks, right? All kinds of different things that we need to go fishing. But you're probably wondering why I'm talking about fishing, right? Because first of all, I'm not a fisherman. Well, in the passage that Pastor Kathy's going to read in just a little bit, in Mark, it talks about Jesus who came across the fishermen. They were out in the boat, and they were fishing. And Jesus said to them, "Come, follow me. I want you to be fishers of men." And do you think those men followed Jesus? Yes, they did. Jesus was calling them to be disciples. And you know what? Jesus calls us to be disciples too. So what kind of things do you think we can do to be disciples for Jesus?
Pray.
Tell others about Jesus, maybe? Right? Be kind to people. Help one another, right? Respect one another. So we too are disciples for and help, right? So we too are disciples for Jesus. We too are called to be disciples. So this week, when you go back to school, do you think you can maybe do some of that? And tell others about Jesus, maybe? Or maybe be kind? Read your Bible? Pray? All right, so let's go ahead and go to God in prayer now. So let's lift our hands. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that you called us to be your disciples. Help us to go out and spread your word to all those in this world, and especially those that are close in your eyes. Help us to be loving, kind, and to care for one another. And help us more to invite others to bring them to church so we can grow our programs and be able to spread the word. We love you and we thank you, for it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 16 through 20. The older you get, the further out you have to hold the Bible. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, so I have to put on my fishing vest this morning, and John's going to help me with the casting net.
Oh dear.
How many of you like to fish? My husband Rusty likes to fish, and our daughter Sarah. They will be out there on the lake. They love to put the bait on. fishing, and Jesus comes along and calls to them. Now, it said they're casting their net. So we have a casting net. This is a modern day one, so the one in Jesus' day would be made out of rope. But still, the same principle would have these weights on it that would hold it and take it down to catch the fish when it goes down. So this is makes a loud noise. Just want to warn you ahead of time. But the idea is to get some, you know, energy swing with it. When they let it go, that it will go a distance and spread out as far as it can to catch as many fish as it can. Right, John?
Right.
All right, so here we go. Ready?
Right.
One, two, three. Pretty good. Pretty good. And then here you pull the string, and then it pulls the weights together and then catches the fish. But in Jesus' day, the net was made out of rope, and they would then go down and gather it up. Remember the one story where they say that Peter put his clothes on, they were fishing, so they were wearing something like a bathing suit or other garments and got dressed because they would dive down in and get the net, bring it up, and catch the fish. So, our scripture is about this story when Jesus comes along and sees Simon and his brother Andrew and calls them to go fishing. So this boat that they would have been in would be about 26 feet long, about the size of a delivery truck. And they did discover a boat on the bottom of the Sea of Galilee not too many years ago. And they dated it between 50 BC and 50 AD. So it could very easily have been a boat that Jesus would have been in on the Sea of Galilee. And they very carefully and tenderly excavated it, and now it is on display in the Holy Lands. So if you can imagine something about 26 feet long, and remember the story of the disciples in the boat, and it's a storm, and Jesus is sleeping, so there would have been 13 people in that little boat on the Sea of Galilee. So, the fishing technique we just demonstrated for you was that the fishermen would cast the net out into the water, and then the weights would pull that net down and get fish, and they would dive in and bring them up. So, if you had lived in first century Galilee at the time of Jesus, for those of you who love to fish, could have very easily have been fishermen, right? What a good livelihood it would have been. You would be able to have some income for your family, plus put food on the table. So that's the way they supported their families and fed their families. And when we read about Jesus, a lot of times we hear that he's either on the Sea of Galilee in the boat, or teaching, preaching, healing, and meeting with the big crowds along the shores of the Sea of Galilee. He spent a lot of time there. So this particular day, Jesus comes along, he sees Simon, and he sees Andrew, and he calls them. And what do? We're told they drop their nets and they follow. So this is where their spiritual journey began, with Jesus. And that's our first point this morning, is where the journey begins. It says, as Jesus passed alongside the Galilee Sea, he saw two brothers, Simon and Andrew, throwing fishing nets into the sea, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, he said, and I'll show you how to fish for people. And notice that Jesus calls ordinary, everyday, normal people to follow him. No special gifts or graces required, just a willingness to follow. And he promised he would show them how to fish for people. He asked them to come on this journey with him. Now, in the Common English Version, it says right away. In the New International Version that we heard this morning, it says immediately. And the No, the Revised Standard Version says immediately. And then the New International Version says right away they came. So you have a sense of urgency. Whatever they were doing, they dropped it, they set it aside so that they could follow Jesus. So I wonder what it was in Jesus' words or the way he said it that would have resonated with them or gave them this desire to follow him. You know, was it the tenderness that they heard? Or was it the authority of Jesus' voice? Because we know the scriptures tell us that he spoke with the authority of God. So maybe they heard that, and maybe they had heard that this rabbi, teacher, preacher from Nazareth had healed somebody, or really had you know, preached a wonderful sermon. We don't know what it was, but something in them stirred, and so they began to follow him. I want you to think about right now when your journey began with Jesus. What was that like? What was it that drew you to him, and where was the situation? Were you in worship? Was it a relative or someone in church or someone that was teaching that invited you to be a follower of Jesus Christ? I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior when I was 12 years old in the youth camp in Leesburg. How many have been to the Methodist youth camp in Leesburg? It's a beautiful place. And we were there for a youth retreat. I think it was a week retreat. I can't remember exactly, but others from our youth group were there. And it was the last night of the retreat, and we were in the chapel. And if you've not been to the Leesburg camp, the chapel has a wall of glass windows that overlook the lake. And on the lake is a beautiful lit cross. And it is a beautiful view. And that was the setting where we were that night. And the pastor of the night gave told a story about seeing Jesus in the camp, what I can remember, and something about what he was saying about Jesus being in the camp. And then he gave the invitation to come to the altar. And I remember feeling this pull on me that I could not resist. There was no way I could stay seated in the pew. And so I came forward, and I was so happy because my friends were there, the friends from the youth group, and it was just a good, joyful time. So we know that once we commit to following Jesus, to become a follower of Jesus, he begins to work in our lives to help us grow, to help us mature. John Wesley spoke of this as Christian perfection, and John Wesley said that he had seen people who had actually attained this Christian perfection, which is being perfect in love of God and of others. That's our goal. And he said that he had seen it usually for people who were close to death. And maybe you've experienced seeing someone like that just has this radiant love and is at total peace. But he said also he had seen it with people 20 years before. So this work that God does in our hearts is not static. It's not stale. It doesn't leave us where we are. It's moving. It's continuing to propel us forward. And so discipleship in the Wesleyan tradition is always going somewhere. There's always more work for God to do in our hearts. And it's a lifelong journey by which God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is at work in us to form us to be the people that God wants us to be, to love God with our heart, mind, body, soul, and strength, and love our neighbors as ourselves. And I learned that when I was taking a disciple Bible study, and I had been a Christian since I was 12 years old, and we were married, Rusty and I, and we had two children in middle school, and I just loved disciple Bible study. I couldn't wait to get to class. And felt that things, like something was bubbling up inside of me. A lot of times reading the scripture, I wouldn't understand, you know, what a class where there would be a video and there'd be discussion from people that have been, you know, studying the scripture. I felt that I had a greater understanding of what God wanted me to do and to be. And the two classes, Disciple 1, Disciple 2, the first class was taught by our pastor, Barbara Riddle, and the second was by the associate, George A. Sevilla. And so was really a wonderful time. And at the end of Disciple 2, the two pastors went to other places. Well, Barbara became a DS and George went to Fort Lauderdale. And so I thought, who's going to teach Disciple Bible study? Don't ever ask God that question. Because I began to realize that he was calling me to. Well, I thought, I don't have enough knowledge of the Bible. So a couple of summers, I went to Canberra School of Theology to take classes. I call it the spin through the Old Testament was one summer, and then the spin through the New Testament the next summer. But then through those times and then teaching Disciple, I began to feel God's call on my life to go into full-time ministry. And so I went to Asbury Seminary in Orlando and got my theology degree, and then was appointed to two churches in Orlando first, and then to a church in Winter Park, and then to Lake Alfred, and now I've been appointed to First Church St. Cloud, and I'm so blessed to be here. So this process of sanctification comes through our entire lives, transforming us, and we never know what God is going to do. Amen? We never know what's going to happen. It's like, okay, fasten your seatbelts and hang on. So the question is, what's your destination? And the series then that we're going to have on a disciple's heart, remember last Sunday we talked about the heart change. We're going to talk about how God works in our hearts. And so as disciples, we participate in that. You know, yes, God does his part, but we also do our part. And we call these things that we do spiritual disciplines. And there are four personal disciplines. Prayer, Regine talked about that with the kids. Scripture meditation, financial generosity, and invitational evangelism. In our corporate disciplines, you're participating in one right now, corporate worship. The second is small group studies. And the third is gifts-based service. And what I'm learning so much about this church already in a short time is the heart that you have for those in need in the community. Big heart, and the service that you do for them. And so I'm very, very pleased. But we can be at different stages in this. You could be someone who is in worship regularly, but not very good at inviting somebody or sharing your faith, maybe. Or maybe you are someone who is faithful in prayer, but not always in worship. Or maybe you're in worship a lot, but you have not yet been able to be generous with your gifts. So we can be at various stages with those different practices. And so I want you to think about this morning those different disciplines that you have been, you know, participating in. And what is your next step? Because that's what's important. That's what God's doing here. And that brings us to the last point this morning is a centering way of life. In Ephesians 2:10, Paul writes this, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." In the United Methodist Church, we have an annual conference, and we have a service of ordination, commissioning for deacons and elders. We had that yesterday. But guess what? It was virtual. So we watched online as they commissioned and ordained new deacons. certain questions, and I want to read three of them to you this morning. First is, are you going on to perfection? The second is, do you expect to be made perfect in love in this life? And he said to them, he said, you can speak louder, you know, because he, I guess they were not speaking up. And then the third thing, are you earnestly striving after perfection in love? Now, those questions are asked of the elders, and of course they answer yes, but that's a, those are questions for each and every one of us as followers of Jesus. Are we growing in love? Are we expecting to be made perfect in love? Perfect love for God and our neighbors. Another way of saying it is, do we have lives that are centered around Jesus Christ? Is he the center of our life? In other words, do we do things that Jesus said and did while he was here? Do we make a decision based on what would Jesus say? What would Jesus do? And if Jesus came through the door this morning and he asked us to follow him, would we immediately drop our nets, drop whatever we're doing, drop our devices, and follow Jesus? That's the question for us today. And he is extending that invitation to us. So I invite you to think about, what is your next step? What is Jesus calling you to do? Because I believe he has big plans for us and wants, as Regine said, for us to grow and go out into this community and share his love and the knowledge of him with all those that we meet. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we love you. We thank you for calling us to serve you, to worship you, to go into this community and show your love to each and every individual we meet. We pray for your guidance and direction in our lives. May we be so focused on you that others will see you in us. In Christ's name we pray.
Thank you. I Let's have a 10 minutes.